Veni Sancte Spiritus, Amen. Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, Amen. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Together let us recite Psalm appointed for today, Psalm 40, beginning at verse 1. Together, I waited patiently for the Lord. He inclined to me and heard my cry. He drew me up
out of the miry bog and set my feet upon a rock, making my steps secure. He put a new song in my mouth, a song of praise to our God. Many will see you and fear and put their trust in the Lord. Blessed is the man who makes the Lord his trust, who does not turn to the proud, to those who go astray in that part of life. You have multiplied, O Lord my God, your wondrous deeds and trust toward us. None can compare with you. I will proclaim and tell them, yet they are more than can be told. Sacrifice and offering you have not desired, but you have given me an open ear. Burnt offering and sin offering you have not required. Then I said, behold, I have come. In the scroll of the book it is written of me. I desire to do your will, O my God. Your law. I have not hidden your deliverance within my heart. I have spoken of your faithfulness and your salvation. I have not concealed your steadfast love and your faithfulness from the greater congregation. As for you, Lord, you will not restrain your mercy from me. Your steadfast love and your faithfulness will ever preserve me.
Glory be to the Father,
and to the Son, to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever.
Amen. We join together in singing the hymn of faith, My Faith Looks Up to Thee, O Thou Lamb of Calvary.
Thank you.
life's dark maze I tread. Griefs around me spread. Dream when death's cold sullen stream shall o'er me roll, blessed
be with you.
And also with you.
Let us together pray the prayer for this Sunday together. Almighty and everlasting God, mercifully look upon our infirmities and stretch forth the hand of your majesty to heal and defend us. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated for the readings and the sermon. The first reading is from Isaiah chapter 49, beginning at verse 1.
Listen to me, you islands. Hear this, you distant nations. Before I was born, the Lord called me. From my mother's womb, he has spoken my name. He made my mouth like a sharpened sword. In the shadow of his hand, he hid me. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." But I said, "I have labored in vain. I have spent my strength for nothing at all. Yet what is due me is in the Lord's hand, and my reward is with my God." And now the Lord says, "He who formed me in the womb to be his servant, to bring Jacob back to him and gather Israel to himself. For I am honored in the eyes of the Lord, and my God has been my strength." He says, "It is too small a thing for you to be my servant, to restore the tribes of Jacob and bring back those of Israel I have kept. I will also make you a light for the Gentiles, that my salvation may reach to the ends of the earth." This is what the Lord says, the Redeemer and the Holy One of Israel, to him who was despised and abhorred by the nation, to the servant of rulers. Kings will see you and stand up. Princes will see and bow down because of the Lord who is faithful, the Holy One of Israel, who has chosen you. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The second reading is from 1 Corinthians, the first chapter, beginning at verse 1.
Paul, called to be an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, and our brother Sosthenes. To the church of God in Corinth, to those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people, together with all those everywhere who call in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, their Lord and ours. Grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I always thank my God for you because of his grace given you in Christ Jesus. For in him you have been enriched in every way, with all kinds of speech and with all knowledge. God, thus confirming our testimony about Christ among you. Therefore, you do not lack any spiritual gift as you eagerly wait for our Lord Jesus Christ to be revealed. He will also keep you firm to the end, so that you will be blameless on the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. God is faithful, who has called you into fellowship with his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. When Renee was reading the Old Testament lesson from Isaiah chapter 49, you know, listen, you nations of the world. It is from this text that we get that canticle called, listen, you nations of the world, listen to the word of the Lord, declare it from, you know, it's right from that passage. And again, I want to remind us that the liturgy often found within Lutheran congregations comes from the Bible. And that's great. Not from people's pious opinions, not from something that I'm doing there in that study, writing things down, like even today, the responses, the liturgy, the words that we are saying comes directly from Holy Scripture. And I hope that will bring great peace and comfort to you, that when you come, that literally all that we're doing is reciting the word of the Lord to us, reciting God's word back to our Lord Jesus. And that's one of the reason, maybe a fundamental reason, why people feel so much at rest and at peace when they come to what we call a liturgical church. Because all you're hearing is God's word in a form, in a pattern that brings glory to the Lord Jesus. Good to know. Good timely reminder. Also, you know, I'm beginning from January the 1st, 2017, all the way to November 2019, at which point then my time here at Grace will be done. You know, we're taking a look at the minor prophets. So I encouraged you then, I will encourage you today and throughout. Bring your Bible. I challenge you, bring your Bible, because it's sort of a preaching Bible teaching, and I'm going to be making references to other places in the Scripture. And, you know, to a certain degree, you'll know nothing if you don't bring your Bible. But if you bring a Bible that you can read and know, maybe even mark, you know, then it'll be a benefit to you. It will certainly be a benefit to our life together as a church community. Suzanne, by the way, during this past month, in the month of December, because I'm preaching on the minor prophets, because I'm teaching downstairs on Sunday morning on the minor prophets, a lot of our Thursday night teaching is how then should we live. It's a social commentary from God's word about society based on the minor prophets. We put together for you who are interested, it's called a parish commentary on the minor prophets. And it is available free of charge. You know, just go to Suzanne. We didn't know how many were interested, so we made limited edition. We'll go into reprinting tomorrow. But take it, you know. It's going to describe to you what each of the books are about. It describes to you a little of the history. It enables you, it equips you to be informed, because one of the things that I hate, one of the things that the Lord hates, is for you to come to church and you're so bored because you haven't been prepared that you do something as horrific as this. Man, church is so boring, you know? Instead of coming prepared, on your knees, praying for us, praying for the pastor, praying for the teacher, praying for yourself that God's word speaks to you and you're open to hear what the Lord has to say, because the minor prophets always point us to Jesus and give us a great commentary about society from their point of view. Are you ready? I can't begin unless you give me permission. We're ready. Amen. And the word of the Lord came to Hosea, the son of Beeri, during the reigns of Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. the kings of Judah. And the word of the Lord came to Hosea, the son of Beeri, during the reign of King Jeroboam, the son of Jehoaz, the king of Israel. That's the text. I'm going to have a quiz for us this morning. You know, I'm excited. Canada is celebrating its 150th anniversary. I can remember here in Camrose, 1967. Canada, one little, two little, three Canadians. How many remember that song, right? I mean, it stuck to me. I was sparling. Art Pfeiffer was the principal. Hello, Art, you know. And the whole year, the school was singing this song. And here I am, 61 and a half, and I still remember it like a little kid. Oh, it's amazing what repetition can do. But the assumption that we in Canada are enjoying is this, that you as a Canadian citizen, and how many of us are Canadian citizens? Please raise your hands. Come on, God knows if you're lying, you know. That you in Canada, you know your prime ministers. That you know all the prime ministers, starting from the very first one to the present day one. That is an assumption that the Canadian government of Canada believes every Canadian. Now, John and Chris are sort of exempt because they have a little, you know, U.S. history. Challenge them about U.S. presidents in just a moment. So join me. Let's see how far we can get. Who today is the present Prime Minister of Canada? Just okay, one for one. Good. Okay, who was before Justin? What was his name? Harper. Before Harper?
Brian Mulroney.
No. Oh, yeah. No. Liberals, yes, but no. Paul Martin, okay. Before Paul Martin, it was a French Canadian that's open this article. What was his name? Jean Chrétien, right? And after Jean Chrétien, the only female prime minister in the Canadian history, she lasted 8 months. What is her name?
Kim Campbell.
Okay. Then came that guy from Baie-Comeau. His name is?
Yeah.
No, Baie-Comeau, northern part, just north of Trois-Rivières in Quebec City. Brian Mulroney. You know, the Progressive Conservatives. Before Brian Mulroney, everyone knows him, a very affable Vancouverite. John Turner. John Turner, remember? Oh, distinguished looking gentleman. And then the infamous pet of Canada. The infamous pet. Pierre Elliott Trudeau. Pet. You know, and there are people who love him and people who hate him, right? The infamous, and you know, besides the energy policy that Pierre Trudeau brought, he brought one thing that I'm going to talk about today, that the Liberal government brought today during his time as Prime Minister, 1980 to 1984, that has been absolutely, is going to be absolutely devastating to Christian faith. And most of us today have been nurtured by this policy, and you don't realize how lethal. It's like getting a poison in you. Instead of giving you the full dose, what they're doing is just giving you a little bit, and a little bit, and a little bit. It was in generation and a little bit. And now the kids today, like Gabrielle, are growing up with this, and she has no idea. But she thinks it's right when, in fact, it is the most lethal, one of the most lethal poisons today. And I'm bold to say that it's called the menace. The menace. And I can cite a Lutheran pastor, a PhD, who's authored one book. I checked with Brother Dave here. Right, David? And this guy is authentic, so it just sort of shocked me, like, wow. But I'll get to that. After Pierre Elliott Trudeau was... Oh, from the Yellowhead district, Joseph Clark. And then before Joseph Clark, the most famous Liberal, probably Prime Minister next to Trudeau, Mr. Peace. Yeah, someone said it. Lester B. Pearson. He is noted as the Canadian international diplomat, peace, the United Nations, Lester B. Pearson. Now we're going to run into some difficulty. Up to this point, we're sort of, okay, now, because we got to go to Saskatchewan for the next guy. Diefenbaker, right? John Diefenbaker, right? Before John Diefenbaker, and most of them come now from Ontario or Quebec. Louis Saint Laurent, William Lionel Mackenzie King, R.B. Bennett, Arthur May, and I don't know who this, he just lasted 1 year. Did you know that? A 1 year term. Unbelievable. Sir Robert Borden, Sir Wilfrid Laurier, Sir Charles Tupper, Sir Mackenzie Bowell, Sir John Sparrow David Thompson, Sir John Abbott, and ultimately bringing us to the first Prime Minister in Canada, Sir John A. Macdonald. Okay, you guys did okay. You did okay. Let me ask a couple other questions about Canadian prime ministers. There are only two prime ministers that died while they were in office, where they actually were sitting as the prime ministers. Who were they? The first one is our first prime minister, John A. Macdonald, and the second one is John Thompson. The only two prime ministers who've ever died in office, unlike the United States of America, where we have several presidents that died while in office. One of the more famous ones being John F. Kennedy, and the other one being Abraham Lincoln from the state of Illinois, or Illinois. I know, John. And finally, the Canadian populace is so familiar with two-party politics. Three-party politics, sorry. Either you are a liberal, or you are a conservative, or you are a NDP, right? But there's only one time that the Canadian Prime Minister was not liberal, was not conservative, was not NDP. Only one time in Canadian history. In fact, this Prime Minister had to merge the Liberals, the Conservatives, and the NDP into a party. Do you know what that was called? Oh boy. How's that? No, that's more. No, they did. The Reform did not merge all three. It was called the Unionist Party of Canada. And it came into existence during one of the most turbulent times, not only in Canada, but in the war, during the war. That under the reign of both Sir Robert Borden and Arthur Mahon, Canada became a unionist state. I didn't know that. How many knew that? Raise your hand. A little bit of Canadiana history. I hope it's been a joy and a delight to you. It does have a biblical reference, so please bear with me just a couple more minutes. We did okay with Canadians, but I suspect that many of us know a lot more U.S. presidents than Canadian prime ministers. So today, who is the president of the United States? His name is?
Trump.
How many know that? Raise your hand. How's that? Yeah, today it's Donald Trump. Before Donald Trump, his name is? Barack Obama. And before Barack Obama? George W. Please note, W, the little kid, they called him the idiot one, you know? Right? He was called the idiot one. George W. Bush. And then before Bush was? Net. Oh, man. Bill Clinton, 8-year time, Democrat. And before Bill Clinton was George W.'s father, his name is George H.W. Bush, the smart one, you know, the dad. Before George Bush, his name was Reagan, you know, the actor turned, you know, politician. Before Reagan, now we're going to get a little dicey here. Carter, yes, well done. Most people have no idea who James Earl Carter is. They think it's James Earl Jones, you know, the actor, Darth Vader, you know, Ernst Kirk. And then after Carter, before Carter? Nit. Gerald, someone said it. Gerald Ford, well done. Nixon, right? What is he famous for?
Watergate,
right? He's one of the few presidents of the United States that has been impeached. In other words, taken out of office. And then we get really some very tender moments here in U.S. history. Before Nixon was Johnson. And how did Johnson come into existence as the president? Kennedy. And at this time in American history, it was Vietnam. I want us to be, and the Detroit riots, the race riots, and the Los Angeles race riots. And more specifically, as it relates to our church life together, during this time in history in North America, I have a dream. I have a dream. I stand on the hill and I have a dream. Dr. Martin Luther King, who was assassinated. And then we get into World War II and the presidents of Eisenhower, the guy who dropped a bomb on Hiroshima. Harry S. Truman. And then before Truman, the guy who led FDR, Roosevelt. And then it just goes all the way down, all the way down. And who was the first president of the United States?
Abraham.
No! The first president of the United States was not Abe Lincoln. It is George Washington. Well, we tried. And there were several presidents who did die in office, and the American conscience, each and every time that they have happened, it pains them to the nth degree. Most notably in American history, the assassination of Abe Lincoln, you know, and the Civil War. The other one that really caught the heart of many Americans was, and even Canadians, was the death of John F. Kennedy, shot in, you know, Dallas, Texas. You know, it literally has changed and turned and, you know, pained the American psyche, political system. Why I'm drawing our attention in such a manner as I start my sermon this morning and we start our venture in the minor prophets is this. The word of the Lord came through a prophet, came through a messenger, Hosea, during the reign of. This word of God is very clear that it is speaking to governments. It's speaking to political leaders, and they have a name, they have a history, and they have caused good and bad in the society that they were reigning. And God is not afraid to step into that social situation and speak the word of the Lord to them. Hosea, sent by God as a messenger, came to the nation. Now, just remind us, you know, the nation of Israel, first of all, wasn't under kings, just to draw our attention. It was just a gathering of people. Remember, Abraham came from the land of Chaldees? You know, God called Abram, and then all of a sudden they were taken to Egypt, and they were enslaved as slaves for 450 years. And then who led the Jewish people out of Egypt? What was his name? Moses, right? Out of the great Exodus, Moses led the people out of Egypt into, and they didn't get into the promised land until they repented, and then God raised up the first real leader, a second, you know, like leader. His name is Joshua. Remember? Joshua. Yeah. What's that song? Of Jericho, Jericho. Remember, and they walked around the city seven times, and then at the end of the seventh time, they went, and the walls came tumbling down, and the walls came tumbling down. Got that? Remember? That's Joshua. And they lived in this new land that God had promised to them. And they had 12 colonies, 12 brothers settling in 12 different regions. And sometimes these brothers got along really well, and sometimes these brothers could kill each other. Sounds like a normal family, right? Well, my goodness. And they lived as these confederations until finally, all of a sudden, brother here was doing that which was evil in the sight of God. And so God raised up a judge to help him. And over here, another brother was doing evil in the sight of God, and God raised up a judge. Until finally, it got so bad that the Lord said, I got to bring these people together. And you move from the judges into what we call the kings. And the people of Israel in 1 Samuel chapter number 8, they say to Samuel, the last of the judges, and he's dying. And what is so sad, Samuel had 2 sons, and they had hoped that these sons of Samuel would be godly men, would be God-fearing men, would be able to lead and guide the people. But they were little hellions. They were hellions. They did not do what was right in the sight of the Lord. And the Lord killed them both. And here the nation had no people, no leader to follow. So they cry out to Samuel and they say this, Samuel, you are old. This is 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 2. You are old, and your own sons do not walk in your way of the Lord. Now appoint us, give to us a king, because everybody around us has a king. You know, everybody, they're looking around, they're going, everybody has a king, and we want a king to lead us. And it makes sense, right? It sounds good, except there's a problem. Guess what that is? Can't we do what everybody else around us is doing, Pastor Greg? Right? Why do we have to be so different? I mean, look around. People, they're not going to church. Why are you doing what you're doing? You know what the problem is? You know what the problem is? The problem is that we don't judge, we're not led by what people think, we're not led by what governments say, we're not led by what society's telling us. The problem is we are a community that's guided by the Holy One of Israel, the one who's living, the one who's alive, and the one who knows the social context of where we live. And the Lord has a word to speak to his people. So he said to the Israelites back then, the Lord said to Samuel, 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 15, listen, Samuel, to the people. It is not you that they have rejected because they wanted a king, but they have rejected me as their Lord and King. Are you catching this? The people of the Lord are saying in the days of Samuel, we do not want to be led and guided by what God is saying. We want to be guided by what the other people are doing. We want to be just like them. And the Lord said to Samuel, to the nation, to his very people, they're rejecting me, Samuel. It's not you. But they're rejecting me. And then the Lord gives them this warning. If you embrace it like that, you will face the deathly punishment of these kings. He warned them. And now we're coming to Hosea. Because the first king was Saul. The second king was David. The third king was Solomon. Solomon had 2 sons, son A and son B. Son A ruled in the south part. It was called Judah. Son B ruled in the north part. It was called Israel. And every king, every bloody king in Israel, all 15 plus of them, they all did. Of them evil in the sight of the Lord. Not a single one was redemptive. You got that? They wanted a king. The people, they got their king, and all of the kings did what was evil in the sight of the Lord. But for people in Judah, Some of the kings, many of the kings were evil in the sight of the Lord. Some of the kings were great, like King Hezekiah. Under his reign, revival took place. Hallelujah. And then there were a few like Uzziah that started out right, started out good, but ended up in the gutter. The word of the Lord came to Hosea, son of Beeri, during the reigns of the kings of the rulers of Judah, Uzziah, Jotham, Ahaz, and Hezekiah. Two were evil, one was great, Hezekiah, and the other one, Uzziah, started out good but ended terrible. And during the reign of King Jeroboam of Israel, he was just terrible. So what was Uzziah's sin? I just want to pick out on Uzziah. My brothers and sisters, if you'll turn, you know, into 2 Chronicles chapter 26 to 30, these four chapters are dedicated to each of the kings, Uzziah, Ahaz, Hezekiah. It says in 2 Chronicles 26 verses 1 to 15, King Uzziah at age 16, pretty young, right? At age 16, started to be the king over God's people. And he lasted 52 years, a long reign. It says in verse 15, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord, like his father did. He started out as a godly man. He started out as someone who fell on his knees and worshiped the Lord and sought the Lord in direction for him. He was the one who let the word of the Lord guide God's people. But then in verse 16, you get this horrific statement. 2 Chronicles 26, verse 15. It says, and he became really powerful, and his pride went before him. You catching that? He became arrogant. He became proudful. Why? Because he got comfortable in his prosperity. He got comfortable in being the top dude. He said that, look at how all things are happening to me. And what he did that was the sin against the Lord, what he did that made God angry at him is this. This government came to the worshiping temple and said this, you're going to worship the one true Lord this way. We, the government, are going to tell you how to bend the knee before the Holy One of Israel. We, the government, are going to tell you how you are to pray, how you are to read, how you are to sacrifice, and if you've got a problem with that, I, the king, Uzziah, will attend to you. Are you catching that? And it says in 2 Chronicles 26, between verses 16 to 30, that this was offensive to the Holy One of Israel. It was so awful in the sight of God that near the end of Uzziah's life, around verse 21 or 22, it'll say that the Lord sent leprosy on that king and got him out of office. And he lived 10 more years in complete isolation. No family, no political friends. No one would go near him because he was a leper. God knows what a nation does. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 15 says to us, nations are but a bucket, a drop in the bucket before the Lord. The Lord regards no nation as greater than or worse than. And that really is the challenge for us today. We must be well aware that God sends prophetic messengers, men and women who have a clear message from the Lord and who will stand up in the face of governments, in the faces of kings, in the faces of prime ministers, in the faces of premiers of Alberta, in the face of local mayors of Camrose and so forth, and will speak the word of God to the administration. Hosea is such a messenger. And as we go on, Hosea 4 to 14, you will hear about the social comments God has to the people, why the Lord is upset with them. Isaiah was a messenger. He was contemporary with Hosea, where Hosea was in the villages, in the towns, going around saying, the word of the Lord is speaking this. Isaiah was in the government places. Read the book of Isaiah, 66 chapters long. He went into exile with the nation, speaking still to the government. You got to repent, repent, repent. Jeremiah was a messenger. You know? Even our beloved ancestor, Martin Luther, was a messenger that spoke to the government of his day. He wrote a treatise. He wrote a 45-page document. If anyone wants to read it, it's in English. I have it. It's called Temporal Authority. To what extent should a Christian obey the government? Please catch this. How far are you to go as a Christian in obeying your government before you have to finally say, I will go no further? How far will you be pushed, pulled, dragged by local administrations before you say, I will go no further than this? Martin Luther, in his day, wrote this document in 1524, and he writes it in light of the peasants' revolt, which took place in his neck of the woods, and over 120,000 men, a lot of women, and a lot of kids died. And they asked Martin Luther, how far can we go? Is it right for a Christian to take arms and defend themselves? Is it right for a Christian to stand and go to war? I mean, these are not stupid, silly questions, because centuries later in Germany, how far before Christians will stand up against a government? How far will you let them build a concentration camp in the outskirts of Camrose, like they do in Ossium, Poland? They knew what they were doing. Auschwitz was a concentration camp first, built for, you know, prisoners. They knew what was going on, and then it got renovated to being an extermination camp. Auschwitz-Birkenau, the citizens knew what was going on. Roman Catholic and Lutherans in the city of Ossium. How far will you go? Bonhoeffer, a Lutheran pastor, stood up and he died. He was martyred for his conviction. He was murdered. He was killed in Flossenbürg. You know, Vietnam and the civil rights movement here in North America, there were Christian spokesperson, the most famous being, one of the most famous Christian spokespersons during Vietnam and the civil rights. What's his name? Dr. Martin Luther King. I have a dream. He's a son of a Baptist pastor. He was a Baptist pastor, and because of his faith in Christ, he called the American conscience to stand up and to say that every person is equal in the sight of God, that every person has a right, and no one is to discriminate, no one is to, you know, tolerate racism, sexism, but to stand up in Christ and welcome people. How far will you go? For him, it meant death. He was assassinated. God will raise up messengers to the people he loves. God is raising up messengers today in Canada. You know, in Canada, we have many virtuous acts that we've done, and I celebrate them in our 150th anniversary. But don't think I'm fooled. You know, Canada imprisoned Chinese people because they were Chinese. Canada imprisoned Japanese people just because they were Japanese. Canada imprisoned German-speaking people just because they spoke German. Our Canada, our nation. And God will raise up messengers. God will raise up messengers that will speak to our governments about the abortion policy which they passed in what year? Became federal law? 1973. And more babies in the womb have been killed in Canada than all of the wars put together. But the Canadian conscience is quiet. God will raise up messengers speaking about human trafficking of people, just not because of sex, but slavery. And the most notorious countries that buy and exchange people for money, not for anything else, but just for money, is North America and Western Europe. God will raise up messengers to speak to us so that we no longer think that we are the cat's pajamas in the world. But we are a nation that needs to repent. Which brings me to that one policy, and then I'm going to close. Pierre Elliott Trudeau brought it in as a legislated law. Do you know what I'm talking about? And don't say the metric system, because you'd be right. But, and please don't say French, because that's also right. But it's something far more deadly, far more. Not gay rights. It wasn't. It's a consequence of the policy he brought in. How's that? Equalization, or we know it as multiculturalism. Every person in Canada, every faith expression in Canada, every culture in the Canadian social fabric is put on an equal par. That's what it means to be a Canadian. So that it is absolutely intolerant and unacceptable for any Canadian to speak up and against any other person, because we are all equal. Well, that may sound great, until you realize that's a bunch of hooey in today's society. You know, Christians are the minority in Canada, and they are coming at, the federal government, the provincial government of Alberta, they are coming directly against the very faith fabric and social fabric of what we as Christians stand for. You know, something as simple as, you know, I grew up, what did they do at the beginning of the school day? What did it go like? It went like, Our Father, who art in heaven. And in today's public school system, you ain't going to find it. When I grew up, something as simple as having at this time of the year a Christmas, you ain't going to find it. Winter celebrations, you know. When will we as Christians realize that our quietism, that our, you know, not letting the Lord speak through us to society is causing a lot of the social ills that we express today? It's not because they're new. It's because you got quiet. Because there wasn't that prophetic word being spoken in God's places like today. Challenging you, speaking to you, encouraging you to stand up. We are not on the same ground as Islamic faith. We are not on the same ground as Jewish faith. Yes, it's a faith expression, but we are completely different, and the only reason why we're different is because of one person and one person only. His name is
Jesus.
He is your Lord. He is your Savior. He has a word for his people today. It is a word that comes to us during the reign of Justin Trudeau. It's a word that will change our hearts. It's a word that, if obeyed, will change the hearts of the Canadian fabric. But if we do not obey this word, if we do not repent, then judgment will fall to us. Amen. Gracious Father, we have begun a real awesome journey where we study the minor prophets. Thank you that someone like even Martin Luther for 2 years spoke daily to Christians in Germany from the minor prophets and taught them and encouraged them. Help us here at Grace to be open to teaching, to be open to direction, to be open to positive correction and where we need to repent, but to be the voice of Jesus in our life together. For I pray this in his name. Amen. Will you please stand and join me in making a confession of your faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed? Together, I believe in Maker of heaven and earth,
and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. For the gift of divine peace and of pardon, with all our heart and with all our mind, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the Holy Christian Church, here and scattered throughout the world, and for the proclamation of the gospel and the calling all to faith, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this nation, Canada, for our Prime Minister, Justin Trudeau, for our cities and our communities, for our mayor, Norm Mayer, and for the common welfare of all of us, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For seasonable weather and for the fruitfulness of the earth, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who labor, for those whose work is difficult or dangerous, and for all who travel, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all those in need, we especially remember those who are hungry, those who are homeless, for the widowed, for the orphaned, for those who have suffered in relationships, for those in prison, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the sick and the dying, and for all those who care for them, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
And on that note, Holy Father, we remember before you one of our own who has passed away this morning. May you welcome, we know that you have welcomed this person into eternal glory because of faith in Jesus. Be with the family at this moment as they make deliberations and discernments concerning the funeral celebration. We also pray for people, Grace Lutheran here. We pray for myself and my family. Bless us, O Lord, with renewal of thy Holy Spirit. We pray for the Bible Baptist Church here in Camrose and Pastor Messick. We lift up before you, Lord, our sister congregation in Dnipro, Ukraine, and Pastor Sergey with his wife Nasty and their child Aaron. And we lift up before you our brother Dale. Ask you, Lord, to bless him, give him strength and renewal of heart and faith. Lord, in your mercy, there's a time of silence now as we lift up those people or events and we give them to the Lord. Finally, for these and all for our needs of body and soul, let us pray to the Lord. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Please be seated. You know, when I was growing up, this wasn't done. It was this. That is to hear the testimony of a brother or a sister whose testimony to Jesus has strengthened them in their life. So Lois, if you'll come up here, and this is the lectern. I'd like to introduce to you our sister in Christ. Her name is Lois Clark Trottier, and she just wants to share how the Lord Jesus has given her strength in her life. You got Stella? Okay, so I'm going to let you be. Just let's have a mic test here, okay? Just speak into the mic, Lois.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you can all hear me.
Can you hear her?
Yeah.
Lord Good. Bless you, okay?
Good. Well, I wrote a book. It's a tiny book, but it has a powerful story in it because of what God did in the life of myself and my siblings. And I always loved books. I know I was programmed from a small child to do this. Growing up, all I ever wanted to be was a nurse and a mother. I never thought I'd ever write a book, but God had other plans. And when my manuscript was complete, because I never took any courses on how to do what I was doing, I just went by all the reading I had done growing up. So I was struggling. The manuscript was complete and I was struggling. And they say that there are the two most important days in your life are, number one, the day you are born, and number two, the day you find out why. And I was blessed to find out why. So on that Sunday afternoon, when I was quietly sitting and struggling in my mind of how to go ahead with this manuscript, these words came into my head, and I heard, "That's why you are here. You were meant to do this. It will all work out fine." Oh, I shook my head and I thought, where did that come from? And then I got really excited and I thought, okay, everything's gonna work out. I'm gonna figure it out and I'm gonna get my manuscript to a printer and I'll get books printed and on store shelves and in the hands of family and friends. And when that happened, I felt love in the air for like 3 days. So I knew I had done what I was supposed to do. But the book is the story of the struggles that my family had because of my father's alcoholism. Instead of caring for his family, he spent his money on his addiction. So we suffered by being hungry a lot of times, by moving because our rent wouldn't be paid. I grew up very fast. I felt old when I was 10 because of everything I witnessed. And my mother struggled. I was the oldest of 9 children, and we were living in Fort McMurray, and that was when the town was small. There hadn't been a boom. And my mother struggled greatly, and I, being the oldest, witnessed this, and she shared with me and talked to me, and you know, things that a child should never have had to know because you just grow up too fast. And I seen her, well, she tried to commit suicide twice, and she had a nervous breakdown once that was very traumatic. She had to go to the hospital, and for children to live through that, it's terrible. And and the shame of your father, and his performance around town was something else that was very hard for me. I felt a lot of shame. So to make up for it, I worked very hard in school, and I tried to be the best that I could be so that they'd know there's some good in the family. And when my mother, she got to the point where she said that she couldn't go on the way it was. She tried getting help, but in those days, there was no help for a mother and her children. There just wasn't. The only time thing that would maybe help you is if your husband was beating you up and the police would come and take him in jail for a night. She talked to the police. We would move away from my father and try to live, but none of it worked. We'd always end up back with him. And so she reached a point of not knowing. She was very desperate. And having 9 children, she thought, how can she move away and take care of all of us? So she told me that she had found a job. It was actually in New Sarepta, and we were in Fort McMurray. And she was coming there to keep house for somebody. And so she left. She left. My youngest brother was 18 months old, and I was 17. And there was 9 of us. So I have a point of view of knowing what she went through. But the younger ones have a different point of view because all they know is they were abandoned by their mother. So my father hired housekeepers for about a year and tried to keep the family together. He bought some new things for the house now that he was in charge of it. But he couldn't keep a housekeeper long either because they didn't want to put up with the drinking either. So after about a year, the 3 oldest ones stayed with him. I was already married because I was getting out of there, but I jumped from the frying pan into the fire. Very poor decision, but anyway, the 3 oldest stayed with him, and then another one lived with my grandma, and another one lived with a friend. So the 3 youngest were put into foster care in town. And so I would see them about town, but we were, some of the families thought it was okay if we visited them, but some didn't. And when we weren't allowed to talk to them, and you see your little brother downtown and you can't hug him or talk to him, that is major pain. It was an awful time. And being the oldest, I wanted to gather them all up and keep them all together and have us all be together. But it wasn't possible. I couldn't do it. So we lived like this. A few years went by. The youngest, Keith, was adopted by a family after they had had him as a foster child. They adopted him, and they moved away. They went to Hay River, but we always knew where he was because they had friends in Fort McMurray, and they would keep in contact. And I would see these people downtown, and they would say, oh, we heard from the Ellisons, and Keith is okay, you know, they're okay. So that would touch my heart. But my sister, the next youngest, Stella, was with foster people with a couple different families. But the last family she was with in Fort McMurray, they wanted to adopt her. But by this time, she was 10 years old, and she didn't want to be adopted by them. She wasn't happy there. She was kind of a tomboy, and they wanted to dress her in dresses and put ribbons in her hair, and she just wasn't happy. So she told her social worker that, and they decided that she was going to be moved to Edmonton. In the meantime, I found out about this, and I phoned and tried to see if I could get her. But I was told quite smartly that no, you have three children. They just insinuated that I wanted her for a babysitter, so, which wasn't true at all. So after I got off the phone and knew that I couldn't get her, I had a major cry down, because I couldn't tell her that I wanted to get her either. I didn't want to tell her. So she was very close with my brother, the older brother, the other third one that was in foster care. They were very close, so the social services took them for lunch together, and they told Wade that Stella was going to be going to Edmonton and be adopted, and they told me she's going to get a good education. She'll be adopted and get a good education. So they took him for lunch, and they told Wade that they were taking her. She was going to Edmonton that day. So, okay, my brother, another brother that was like 14 or whatever, was in the restaurant that day, and he seen what was going on, so he knew that she was leaving. And so he phoned me later to tell me that she was gone. And I guess my brother Wade told the social worker, he said, well, if you're taking her, I'm gonna chase that car. And he did. That was her memory, leaving Fort McMurray in a car going to the airport with her brother running behind. It's just like a movie, and I realized that I lived this, we lived this, so there could be a book, because God wanted a book. I know the way I was led that I was supposed to do this book, so we all had to live this. So Wade, at the age of 15, he ran away from his foster home, and he came to where I was. And the social services said he's 15, and if he's going to run away, we don't want to send him back because he'll just run away again. So can you take him? So I said, oh, sure. I talked to my husband, and he moved in with us. And we knew where Keith was because he was in Hay River, but we never knew what happened to Stella after she left. And over the years, we would talk about her and wonder, and I went about different ways trying to find her. I went through social services and the ombudsman and different ways. And do you know the saying that let go and let God? Because that's what I did finally. I finally said, there is nothing else I can do. I just got to let it go. And you know what? It was about 2 weeks later that I met her. So, honestly, anyway, in the meantime, I had a very controlling, abusive husband in Fort McMurray, and I ended up moving to Camrose in 1978. I had a brother that had married a Camrose girl, and they lived out at Meeting Creek. So they helped me move to Camrose. So I'm in Camrose, starting another life with my children. And Stella, after a year in Edmonton with a foster family, she was adopted by a family from Balfe. So, and she was 11 when she went to Balfe, so she had been living in Balfe. And the day that we met was 12 years later. 12 years had gone by. And so she was 22. So the last time I'd seen her, she was 10. So she looked a little different. But God does his work, his wonders, and his Holy Spirit was working through me. I decided that day that I would do my grocery shopping at the Safeway store in Camrose. Usually I went to the little Super A. I didn't have a car, but a friend would drive me, and she drove me to the Safeway. I said, I think I'll go to the Safeway today. And so, you know how it had two doors, like an east door and a west door? And my groceries are already going through the lineup, and I'm waiting to pay for them. And something just made me turn around, and I kind of turned around, and I seen this young woman behind me in another lineup. And I looked at her, and I thought, she looked like my brother Keith. I had seen him a year before, so she resembled him. And if I hadn't seen him a year before, I never would have noticed her. But I thought, I kept looking at her, and I thought, now if I could see her little finger, because my siblings had little turned fingers, their little finger kind of turned like our grandma, and I thought, if only I could see her little finger, I would know if it was her, you know, because my mind is going crazy. But of course I couldn't see her finger. She's holding her groceries, and she just had a few groceries and I had a big cart full. So, and she noticed me looking at her too, I guess. But anyway, I said, no, I'm not going to talk to her. Like, you see people all the time that look like other people, and it's not them. So I don't want to embarrass myself, you know. So I thought, I'm not going to say anything. Well, guess what? The Holy Spirit thought, we got to nudge this lady. I felt a warm feeling come all right over me, and I felt a tug at the top of my head pulling me this way. So I knew, I thought, oh, okay, I have to talk to her. Well, these were the days when the young men would help you out with your groceries. They'd push the cart out to the car for you. So there's young man's waiting for me with my groceries, and I knew she was still waiting to be waited on, so I knew I had a few minutes. So I ran with him. I left my groceries outside the car. The car was locked because my girlfriend had gone somewhere, and I just left them there. I thought, I don't care if I lose them. It don't matter. I have to catch this young woman. And there's two doors, and I went out the east door, and I don't know to this day why I did it, but I ran around to the west door. I didn't go inside the store. I went outside. So obviously I was led. And I get there, and just as I get there, she's coming out. And then I thought, now what do I say to her? I'm like, what do I say? So I looked at her and I said, you look like somebody I used to know. Do you mind telling me your name? Well, she said her name was Jan Bomer. Well, that did nothing. I thought, that doesn't help. So then I said, were you adopted? And she said, yes, I was. So I knew right away. I said, were you Stella Clark? And she said, yes, I was. Well, imagine, we're standing outside those doors of Safeway, and, you know, it's a miracle. It was a miracle. So she lives on an acreage between Balfe and Daysland, so I can see her anytime I want. Thanks be to God. And I guess I'll end my story now, but.
Will you join me in giving thanks to the Lord who's brought this family together? It's wonderful. Gracious Father, we thank you for leading and guiding Lois here to Grace, but even more important, for reuniting her family. In the midst of some very severe trials, you have not abandoned her, but you are the faithful one. And now, Lord, continue to encourage us in your faithfulness through the witness of Jesus to Lois here at Grace. For we pray this in your name. Amen. Thank you. That's one. That book, they can read it, right? If they have to ask you for it? Yeah, okay. Do read it. It's a short book, but it's a very powerful book on that. Ushers, please come forward. We'll receive the offering and enter into Holy Communion. Congregation, will you please stand? Join me silently as I pray. Gracious Father, we give thee but thine own, whatever the gift may be. All that we have is thine alone, a trust, O Lord, from thee. Amen. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins,
God is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Together, most merciful God, we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean.
We have sinned against you, God, word and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your presence in eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we
in the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. The next day, John saw Jesus coming toward him, and he said, "Look, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. This is the one I meant when I said, 'A man who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me.' I myself did not know him, but the reason I came baptizing with water was that he might be revealed to Israel." Then John gave this testimony. "I saw the Spirit come down from heaven as a dove and remained on him, and I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' I have seen and I testify that this is God's chosen one." Well, the next day, John was there again with two of his disciples when he saw Jesus passing by, and he said, "Look, the Lamb of God." And when the two disciples heard him say this, they followed Jesus. And turning around, Jesus saw them following, and he asked them, "What do you want?" They said, "Rabbi, where are you staying? Come, and you will see." So they went and saw where Jesus was staying, and they spent that night with him. It was about 4 p.m. Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, was one of the two who had heard what John had said and who had followed Jesus. The first thing Andrew did was to find his brother Simon and tell him, We have found the Messiah, that is the Christ. And Andrew brought him to Jesus. Jesus looked at him and said, you are Simon, son of John. You will be called Cephas, which means Peter. This is the gospel of our Lord. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. Again, after supper, Jesus took the cup and gave thanks. Then he gave this cup for everyone to drink, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me. Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we now await his coming in glory. Pour out your Holy Spirit, that by this Holy Communion we may know the unity that we share with all your people in the body of your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. For through him, with him, in him, and in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, Almighty Father, now and forevermore. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. We join together in singing Lamb of God, communion assistant. Please come forward.
Do
that for Jesus' sake. God forgives you all your sin and sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Depart in his peace. Amen. Please stand and we sing. Gracious Father, that through this most holy and salutary gift you give to us, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, whose very presence forgives us all our sins and who calls us to follow him in this world. Help us, O Lord Jesus, by the working of thy Spirit to empower us in our witness to you and the mercy of the Father through you. For we ask this all in your name. Amen. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated for announcements. There is a lunch, or is that right, Bernice? Yeah. There's food downstairs following announcements.
Before I give announcements, I want to just, I haven't had a chance to do it, but thank all the people who came caroling. We kind of had quite a schedule this Christmas, but everybody really came out. I have to tell you, though, the one night we were down on numbers and we all went and did the best job we could. And then Erna shared with me later that what people appreciated most, and Daryl's not here this morning, was we had Daryl reading the scripture. He read from Luke and said that a lot of groups didn't come and read, but our group had read. And so really the work that we were so worried about, we didn't have enough people to sing, but what people appreciated was just bringing the Word of God. So we were very thankful that she shared that with us, that really that the work had been done for us. We didn't have to worry. So just a few announcements. On Wednesday is we're back in the swing of things with the Wednesday morning drop-in devotional at 10 o'clock. And then at CLBI, opening classes, relational evangelism, telling the story of Jesus with Reverend Dean Rodstad on Monday evenings at CLBI at 6:30. The Circuit Forum at Zion Wetaskiwin is coming on Saturday from 10 till noon. I assume that's this Saturday from 10 to noon. And tomorrow, though, don't forget about coming to Grace Lutheran Women on January 16th at 1:30. So bring yourself and bring some friends. Everybody is welcome. We don't forget about on Thursday, how should we then live? A six-part looking at Christian life. And now we'll go back to Tuesday. Tuesday is a movie night. It's called Love Begins. It's a prequel to the Love Comes Softly movies by Janet Oakey at 7 p.m. You'll be all ready for Valentine's Day by the time you have that movie. And not to forget about the healing prayer service on this Wednesday, January 18th at 7.
Good morning. I just want to announce that Saturday, January 28th at 11:30, there will be a ladies' luncheon. Our guest speaker will be Sister Gordia from the Sisters of Mary. Her theme will be Let My Heart Be a Quiet Sanctuary. Admission will be a small salad and a love offering for the sisters. And there'll also be a book table, and everyone is invited. I guess that includes the men, if they'd like to come. And also, I'd like to tell you that Daryl Seib has very graciously built us a prayer box. For those that aren't able to get a hold of the people that pray on Wednesday evening, we'll have the box in the foyer, and you can put your prayer requests in there. Also, if you're shy or there's prayer requests that you would rather give anonymously, you can put them in there as well. It'll be a locked box, and I'll be the only one that will be reading your prayer request, and we will pray over those requests on Wednesday. And let's see. The prayer team is myself and Donna Schroeder and Bernice Stauffer, Gertie Gansky, and Judy Astley, and Louise Kurtz. So you can talk to us if you would like a prayer prayed for you on Wednesday. Thank you.
All the other announcements are in the bulletin. I've got this to your attention. This is fellowship time downstairs. Let's stand and sing, Lord, dismiss us with your blessing.
Thank you.